Hey guys, so I've decided I've had enough with using the other camera, my iPhone. I'm not going to mess with it anymore. It's just too much of a pain in the ass. So I'm just going to have to deal with the audio that I don't like. I've got my eye on a better microphone that might make things better. I think the problem is trying to record things through a microphone hooked to your computer is always going to be somewhat problematic, but I don't know. I'll try another microphone and see what happens. I'm not going to spend a shitload of money on a microphone. Making YouTube videos for free is not something I'm willing to spend a shitload of money on, so, I'll buy another mic for $50 and see what that does. If that doesn't work, fuck it. We'll just keep doing what we're doing. Anyway. So this is what the Cromwell looks like now, after the oil work is done. The next thing I'm going to do to it is pigments, oil streaks, like old grease stains and stuff like that. Not many of them. And then dirt, accumulated dirt. So I'm going to show you a couple of pictures right now of what this thing looks like currently, before I do anything. I didn't really do that in the last video, so this is what it looks like after the oil work is done and dried. I had to wait a couple of days for the oil paint to dry before I could do anything else. So that's what it looks like at the moment. There, showed you. So what I'll do now is I'll have to move the camera to do this because it's not in a spot where I can really show you practically. I'm probably going to go with an overhead kind of aspect because that's the easiest way to show you what I'm doing. Because I do the work mostly with the tank lying on its side, like that. So having the camera pointing down is probably the easiest way to do it. So the work that I do next is oil work on like grease stains and stuff. So around like fuel filler ports like these, a little bit of oil work around the hatches, right? And around the wheel hubs and stuff like that, a little tiny bit, and like accumulated grit and grime around some nooks and crannies. I'm not going to do a whole lot. If I go overboard on this tank, it'll make it look like it's been sitting in a farmer's field for 20 years. It's getting close to looking that way now. We have a tendency to overweather our models. It's a trend that we've been getting into lately. It seems to be a thing these days that we all think that Second World War vehicles were 150 years old when they rolled into battle, when actually they were only months old. A lot of them, and they were actually quite well looked after. And it's only after they were knocked out and abandoned that they started to look like shit. While they were in practical use, they really kind of weren't. Some did. There are exceptions. There were some that looked a little bit beat off, but not the vast majority of them didn't look like that. The vast majority of them were fairly well looked after. So they weren't all beat to shit and, rust buckets and stuff like that. They did have chips. They did have scratches and stuff like that. But they were in fairly good condition. And mine right now is right on, I think, at the maximum edge of wear and tear for what a vehicle would look like on the extreme. If I go any further with it, it'll look wrong. Mine looks like something that probably landed on the beach in Normandy, fought its way all the way through Normandy, and is a bit of a combat veteran. That tends to be what we've been doing lately. We don't tend to like building vehicles that are brand spanking new and look like they just rolled off the factory floor with a little bit of sand on them, which is what a lot of them look like a few days after the D-Day landings. In at least on this topic sense that I'm talking about anyway, most of them looked fairly new, not a scratch on them, just dirt. But as modelers, we don't like that kind of thing. we seem to be allergic to it. The next build that I'm going to do Is actually a friend of mine gave it to me, and I'm gonna build it in connection with another kit that a friend of mine gave me. So the two of them are gonna probably be together, and both of them are gonna represent vehicles that are in fairly good condition with minimal wear and tear weathering. They'll have environmental like dirt, but rust and streaks and stuff like that, and weathering to the paint and everything will be very minimal. So it'll be interesting to see what that looks like when it's done. So, but anyway, enough blathering. So what I'm going to do in this video is I'm going to do a little bit of work, just a little bit of work with grease stains around the filler ports and around the wheels, a little bit around the crew hatches, not much. And then once that's done, the next thing I'll do is dirt. So I'm going to do a little bit of caked in mud in behind here. Now, normally I would do that with the wheels off. It's not normal for me to do with the suspension already on, like at this point right now. Normally I have the wheels off and the tracks off at this point when I do this. The only reason that I did it this way is because I found it easier to deal with the tracks, because these are workable tracks. They're rubber tracks and they're really shitty Tamiya ones. I find when I have to deal with these, it's just easier for me to do it this way. Putting them on afterwards tends to chip off the paint and make it's annoying to try and fix that. So I tend to do it when it comes to rubber tracks. I tend to weather them all inclusive. Makes it harder to do what I'm about to do, but I figured I would show you how to do that. That way you would know how to do that, because it's the hardest way to do it, right? So weathering with the tracks installed, with the wheels installed, is the most difficult way to do it, but it's not impossible. It's just difficult. So I figured I'd show you how I do it, and hopefully you would see that it's not as hard as you might think. I mean, I painted these wheels and these tracks. I painted the tracks separately, like in primer, and then installed them after I painted the wheels, right? So the wheels were painted, and then I installed the tracks, and then painted, I touched up the tracks while they're on. But I haven't even weathered the tracks yet, in all honesty. And I'm not going to. The tracks that the British used were, what were they made out of? Magnesium, I think they were. They weren't steel. They had an alloy, and it didn't rust. So the weathering that these tracks would get would be dirt and dust and mud. And since in this case the vehicle's driving on a gravel road, it's mostly just going to be dust with then shine on the contact parts of the track. So for this case anyway, that's how these tracks will be weathered. For American tracks, they tended to be steel and they rusted a lot more. And German vehicles, they as well, because the tracks tend to be larger, except for like on Panzer IVs and Hetzers and stuff like that. But they tended to rust a bit. Now, all of those tracks, they were coated in like a black lacquer, thick lacquer paint to help protect them. But that lacquer tended to wear off around all the contact points. So you had like a black lacquer paint, and then all the contact areas were rubbed off to a shiny steel. And then whenever the vehicle was parked overnight, it tended to accumulate some rust, so they rusted a bit. If they were parked for longer periods, they tended to rust a lot. So it's just the nature of metal tracks. And depending on the climate too, the climate would change the rate at which they would rust, right? So, and they would literally rust overnight. It's quite a rapid process. But like I said, the British used a different type of tracks, but the metal was, I think it was magnesium. I seem to remember reading it when I was doing research on the Valentine and the Matilda. That's when I came across that. I actually didn't know that up at that point. I thought it was kind of interesting. So they wouldn't rust, not like American or German or even Russian tracks. But they would definitely be covered in dirt and mud and all that stuff. So the first thing I'm going to do after I do the oil stains is I'm going to do a little bit of accumulated dirt in around the running gear. That'll be the first thing that I do. And then I'll do a little bit of oil work back on the wheels, So I'm going to do a bit of oil work first to do the grease stains, and I'll do the dirt, and then more oil work to stain the dirt. That's what I meant in the last video about it's kind of a multi-layered effect. So I'll show you how I do that. Then after they do that, I'm going to do dust with pigments. Now there's a specific way I do that that a lot of other modelers probably don't do that. I have a way of fixing certain things and not fixing others. Fixing by, I don't mean by repairing, I mean by attaching. So using a fixer. So I'll show you how I do that. So that's where I'm going to go with this. So I'll get the camera set up and I'll get started working on that. And then we'll get going. I've already blathered enough. Okay, so the first thing I'm going to do is the oil stains and stuff like that. And I've discovered that in order for me to film this, I need to get rid of the paper towel that I always have on my bench that I use well, basically just as like a drop cloth because the white makes it too hard for the camera to see. I also have to be careful not to do that because I keep forgetting that this microphone that I'm using sits on the bench. And any thump, bump, or bonk I make on the damn thing gets translated and knocks your speakers across the room. So, I do have, see? Messes with the camera. So I have to keep it out of shot. What I am going to put on this are these. I have a little bit of lamp black and some burnt umber oil paint. And I'm going to squirt it on my little bit of paper towel here because that's going to be my palette. Get them open. One thing, if you're going to be buying oil paints and doing your own work like I do, like this, get yourself a handy dandy little wrench because these things here are bugger on your hands to try and open. Once you've had them for a few years. Now I only need a little itty bitty teeny weeny bit of paint. I'm mixing these two together. Amount of paint that I just put on here, and I'm going to show you here in a second. Just that amount there. That is enough to do 20 tanks. So, but the problem with the way the oil comes out of the tubes is it's very hard to squirt out smaller amounts than just a like a thumbnail sized. Just because of the nature of the tube. So it's just the way it is. But even that is more than I'll need. So I'm going to need some thinner, which I have, and a small pointy brush, which I have. And I mix a little bit of the brown and the black together. Make kind of a nice oily black brown color, and that is going to be my grease color. And I'm just going to, if I can see, because my lights are in the way, I have to move them so that they're still functioning, but I'm not banging my head on them. Just need can't see a freaking thing. I have to put on my geek goggles. See if that helps. Whoa, I haven't used these in a while. I use my other ones over on the other bench more than I use these ones. These are all dusty. Just need a little trail. I have no idea if these things are actually grease nipples on these. I could probably do a bit of research and probably find out. But the amount of dirt that I'm going to put on here after I'm done this, it doesn't really matter. So now you don't want to go and do every single grease nipple or leak point or whatever. You don't want to do that because it looks, it's excessive. A little bit of paint caught that one. More than I can actually cover. So that doesn't really matter because I'm going to be covering it with dirt anyway. But just in case. I can't get it out. Well, that's what weathering's for. Like I said, not every wheel has to have stains, and they certainly don't have to be the same. You can have a huge one like I'm doing here on one, and then the rest of them all little ones. And just enough to get the idea of what it is you're trying to show. This would be one of those things that a little tiny bit of hand-eye coordination is sort of necessary. Doing now is you're doing a wet version of one. I'll add different kinds of stains, like the long streaks that are hard and have hard lines, and then other ones that are more like runs, like this one. They dry differently. And if you want them to appear wet, like later on, you go back and add a little tiny bit of gloss paint over them and they shine up. Takes a second to do that. I do that all the time. So after your model's finished and you want to go in and you want to make any stains that you made look like they're wet, just go in and add gloss paint to it. It's the easiest way to do it. Rather than try to make paint with a gloss paint and then try to preserve that effect over time, it's easier just to go back in and add gloss to it after you're done. I've done that many times. It's a pain in the butt to try and preserve it while you're doing your weather process. So don't bother. It's a waste of your time. Alright, that's good. That's what I was looking for. Might add a little bit here. Just for something to do. Alright, do the other side. Trying to do this without getting my gripping bald head in the way. It is a very big head, so it's not always easy. hanging it on the lights. Ding. Oh, must be important. Ian White sending me a picture of something he's working on. Oh, no, it's Barbarossa 641's problem. Holy shit. Any of you guys ever get a chance to check out his channel? Well, that's nice work. There's a friend of mine, Ian White, just sent me a picture. I haven't had a chance to watch that video. I must have just come up. Or he posted it on... Posted it on Facebook somewhere. Looks like Facebook. Anyway, I'm blathering. Blah, blah, blah. Not important. All right. So, next thing I'm going to do. I don't want to be holding this while I do this. That's a mistake. Steady hands. All right. Now, I'm going to check the focus. Because I don't have the autofocus turned on. Leave it turned on for a minute because I can't see what it's doing. So hopefully this will go well. Alright, so now I'm going to do a little bit of a fuel stain around this thing. I have no idea if this is actually a fuel port or not. I think it is. But now when you're doing fuel stains or grease stains around fuel, don't put it on the actual cap. Put it around it. Otherwise, it looks funny. I've worked around tractors a little bit, and whenever there's fuel stains on the tractors, fuel ports and stuff like that, they don't tend to have much of the way of fuel stains actually on the fuel cap. It's around it. So I think one of these is probably antifreeze, and the other one's probably fuel, but I don't know which is which. Bit of research would probably fix that right up. Notice me doing it. Here I go. Running off to go do research. Yeah. Worked out well. I'm so much smarter now. Okay. So that's done. I'm going to put a little bit around this hinge point. Make that all dirty. Just for shits and giggles. Once I do all this oil work, I have to let it dry couple of days before I move on to anything else, because if I disturb it too much with pigments and stuff like that, the pigments stick to it a funny way and it doesn't look very good. So I have to let it sit for a while. It's kind of annoying. That's the thing about oils, though. If you don't do it, you end up paying for it. Working with oils is different. There's lots of benefits to it, though. But there's also lots to working with other materials that are a little bit faster. But I tend to mix them up. Like the weather I'm going to do on the tracks, I'm going to do it with clays, clay washes, and pigments, which are very fast to work with. I can't remember where the track tightening. I think it's back there. No, that's in there. That's the track tightening right here. So there's a not in shot. Sorry. These are the track tightening things. That's what I'm talking about. Sorry about being out of shot there. I get busy in my head and I forget what I'm doing. And I'm not supposed to be holding the tank. See, normally when I'm not filming, I hold the tank. And that way I can hold it right up to my face where I can see. But when I'm filming, I don't do that. Because then it's out of shot all the time. So, because the camera's not in my eyes. It's just a habit. So, alright, so that's the first bit of grease there that I'm going to put on. Now, after I do pigment work, I'll come back and do more. And the second layer that I put on, these are like an understain. And then when I come back again after I do the pigment work, it'll be kind of a wet version of it. So I will add a shine to it with gloss paint after it's all dry. Alright, I'm gonna clean this brush off. The only use I have for Tamiya's lacquer thinner is to clean my brushes. I don't have any other, because it stinks like, wow. I want to smell what the grave smells like. Pretty sure to me a lacquer thinner is it. Mr. Hobby thinner is the same. I got some of that around here. I never use either of them really. Not for anything. I used to use that Hobby thinner for trying to fix the MIG paints, but I stopped using the MIG. I stopped using that thinner. Alright, so that's it for the grease on there. I'm not going to do anything more on there. I'm going to let that dry. For you guys, it's only going to be a moment. For me, it's probably going to be a day, maybe two. And then I'll come back and start on the pigments. And we'll see how well that goes. So, back in a sec. Alright, so what I'm going to do now is add the pigments to this thing. I'm going to start off by doing the major dirt part, like dried dirt that's adhered to the side of the vehicle along the in underneath the sponson and the middle of the wheels. Now, basically the way I'm going to do that, I should actually back up a bit. Because of the way I painted this thing and the thinners that I used on this thing, I have to fix my my pigments to this thing using a specific thing. That was a lot of use of the word thing. Sorry about that. Okay, because I used the oil, the mineral spirit or oil terpenoid thinners And I weathered this thing using mostly oils. I have to use an acrylic thinner, and I'm going to use X20A, this stuff here, as my fixer. It's a nice, simple, easy way to fix pigments to models and stuff like that. I don't usually prefer to do it this way, but because I used oils to do this, I kind of have to. Normally, I actually weather vehicles in a completely different way now. I don't actually do it this way anymore. The next series of videos that I do on the next vehicle that I do, I'm going to do the same sort of thing I did for this vehicle, but in the way that I do it now, where there's almost no oil work at all, really. It's all clay-based and pigments. There is some oils used, but not like I'm using them now. And when I get to this stage, instead of using the X20A as a fixer, I use the terpenoid. That came out of nowhere. I use the terpenoid as a fixer. I find it more effective. Anyway, now that's out of the way. Now the pigments that I use, you can't buy in stores because I make them. They're all made out of chalk pastels. That I buy either on Amazon or on eBay, or I go to the local art store and I buy them there. It's like $10, and you get a bunch of sticks and you just grind them up in a mortar and pestle, or scrape them off with a hobby knife, and you grind them up into a fine powder. There you go. That's what they look like. That's actually the first color I'm going to use. It's going to be for the dry dirt that I'm going to put on. Let's see. Now I don't subscribe to the use of the over-the-counter stuff because there's too much tunnel vision that goes along with it. They tend to label things with too specific labels. Like they sell you a jar of pigment dirt like that and say, this is European earth. Well, I don't know, people who've been to Europe, there's lots of different colored earth in Europe. I've never been to most of Europe. I've only been to a little tiny piece of it. And just from doing research and studying photos and the bits of Europe that I've been to, there's lots of different colors. Labeling something like that is stupid and leads to people getting stuck in these little boxes of creativity and they can't get out. So I don't particularly care for that kind of thing. So I won't buy that over-the-counter stuff. I don't have any use for it, especially when I can just make it myself. This takes about maybe 5 minutes to make, and it costs about maybe $1 to make two or three of these tubs. Actually, that's not true. Maybe $1 to make one of these tubs, right? And it takes about maybe 25 minutes to make the amount that's in here, up to about halfway full. And that would be enough pigment to do several models, like large models, right? Big ones. There's no way you're going to be able to convince me that buying it in a store and paying $15 with taxes, having to drive there, drive back again, spending the money on gas, or having to buy it online and then paying $15 for it, because that's what it would cost me with shipping, and then waiting 3 weeks for it. That's a convenience product, because it isn't. I can just drive to my local art store and buy enough supplies to make dozens and dozens and dozens of these things and just have them here on hand. Having it on tap is a lot easier. So, no, not convenience. Sorry. Misnomer. Right, so I'm gonna just tap this stuff in. So I'm picking it up on the end of my brush and tapping it in. Now, normally, I mentioned this before, I wouldn't have the tracks on this thing or even the wheels when I do this. And It does make it easier when you do that. However, when I found when I have a workable suspension like I have on this thing, it makes it actually sometimes more difficult to work with because the very soft rubber tracks get in my way. So I prefer sometimes, but not all the time, to have to fix that. I prefer sometimes, but not all the time, to do it with the track still on. Was trying to move my head in so I could see what I was doing, but I bumped my head on the lamp instead and took the shade off. All right, so I'm gonna put pigments in there and in there. Now I'm using the pigments that I'm the pigments that I've chosen are the same pigments that I've chosen to weather the other vehicles that are on the diorama. So they're the same palette of colors. All right. Now, when you have the vehicle in this position, it's usually a good idea to do the back side of the tires on the other side. Don't forget them. They're more visible than you think when they're sitting on a diorama base or even a standalone, especially actually on a standalone because you don't have interference from like vegetation and stuff like that from the diorama. Now, the effects of the pigments, the way you're putting them on, is gravity based, so you're putting it on all of the surfaces that the fixer is going to hold it to. So anything that's flat like this, that's where you want to add the pigment. And then you're going to flip over the vehicle and do the other side. I'm only going to do the one side right now, but it's only the areas that are obvious where the accumulation of dirt that you're applying would accumulate. So like this is all track and earth that's thrown up by the track. So I'm adding that to areas that would be contaminated by like track throw. So around the fenders and around the sides of the fenders in the back and along where the back of the sprockets are and stuff like that. And I know you can't see those on there because I'd have to move the model and I can't do that right now because it's loose pigments are on there. So I'm grabbing another color. This is a darker color. And this is the way I usually do things. I usually add multiple colors and I stack them. Adds tonal variety. You don't want to make this stuff too thick, because if you make it too thick, the thinner doesn't activate it properly. Doesn't the capillary reaction is pretty intense, but it doesn't grab it and pull it in because there's too much material. That one. Two more colors to go. All right. Now, I have to admit that I haven't used this as a fixer in a really, really long time. So, I don't know how well this will go. I actually may end up having to use the terpenoid as a fixer, because this stuff just isn't effective. We're going to find out right now. So when you add the fixer, oh, it's nowhere near as effective. When I do that with terpenoid, it goes everywhere like lightning fast. When you add the fixer, try not to touch your pigment at all. Only touch like areas that don't have pigment on it and let capillary action pull it around. Yeah, I'm only just going to do this wheel with the to me extra thin. I'll do the rest with the terpenoid, because this isn't going to be anywhere near as effective as I need it to be. Normally, I'll show you the difference here in a second. You'll see what I'm talking about. I knew there was a reason why I hadn't used to me extra thin in a long time, and why I stopped doing this weathering process. It's not ineffective, it's just I found the new one that I use to be less time consuming. Alright, I need another brush because I can't use that one. Alright, so now I'm using the terpenoid. This one was done with the to me extra thin. This one will be done with the terpenoid. Get it in there. Eh, maybe it won't be as effective. Doesn't seem to want to spread. Oh, there it goes. Might be because I can't see what I'm doing. Being blind. The thing about the capillary action of the terpenoid is it's long term, so I'll take a small amount of the terpenoid and touch it, and it just keeps going around and around and around, and then I'll come back and look at it later and it will have completely enveloped the entire tire. Our entire wheel. Pretty strong stuff. See that one there, still it just seems to have stopped. That's the to me extra thin one. I made changes to the way I do weathering and all that stuff some time ago, and the methods that I'm showing now, I've actually changed the way I do that, and I've adapted new ones. And I'll show you those too in the next series of videos, but the ones that I use in this video, this series of videos, are quite commonplace, including using the thinner I'm using right now. Lots of folks use this stuff too. Or they use actual over-the-counter fixers, which are the same thing. Most of the time they're either alcohol-based or they're mineral spirit-based, but they're the same thing. Gonna find out what happens when I use terpenoid and to me extra thin at the same time in there. I have no idea, I've never done it before. Probably nothing good. But can't see. Now, once this is fixed, dried, takes a few hours, 2 or 3 hours for it to dry, you can come back and add more layers. Usually, I don't make the decision to add more layers until after it's all dry. I kind of leave it open until then. Because there's too many variables. I don't know how it's going to react or what it's going to look like until it's dry. Sometimes I think it looks too dark or it's too light and I need to add more color. So I usually leave my options open. Okay, so that's one side. Now I'm gonna let that sit and dry. You can speed it up with a hair dryer, but if you did it right now, you'd actually harm it because the pigments aren't settled enough. You'll actually move them. You'll disturb them when you do it. So you gotta wait a little bit. I'd suggest maybe 40 minutes. Wait about 40 minutes before you come at it with the hair dryer if you really are in that much of a hurry. So, but anyway, so I'll come back once this is dry and I'll flip it over. Actually, what I'll do is I'll do the other side and then I'll come back and then I'll talk about maybe adding some more colors to it. Okay, guys, so the last thing I'm going to do for this before I go back in with a little tiny bit of oil work is to add the last bit of pigments. So what I did after I finished the pigment work on here where I built up the earth is I hit it all. Well, actually, I went all the way around. As you can see, I did it in there and I added it all under the fenders and along the sponsons and stuff and under there. So I did all that, and the next thing that I'll do is do the pigment work on the upper surfaces. Now, there's not a lot of that. There's only a little bit. Gonna get the brush. Nope, not that one. Where'd it go? This one. I just had it. Oh, it's over there. Put a tool down. Poof, it disappears. It's like it's got feet. All right, so now I'm going to take a little bit of pigment. Now this pigment is just ground chalk pastels, and I'm going to rub it in, literally grind it in to the areas around, like the crew passage areas. You don't have to fix this because you're literally grinding it right into the paint. It's quite stuck in there. Now, if you touch that with your finger, it'll probably come off. But I don't worry so much about that kind of thing because, well, I don't play with my models. So, you know, generally, if I pick them up, I pick them up by the underside. And I don't move them around very often. And if I'm going to transport them anywhere or anything like that, I'm careful not to touch the pigments, because there's a chance I might accidentally rub them off. They're fixed fairly well. You know, you could touch them a little tiny bit and you're not going to completely obliterate them. But, you know, if you touch them too much, I mean, it is chalk pastel being held on by a thinning medium. So it's, you know, not absolutely bulletproof. So when you give it some abrasion, like rubbing it with your finger, it's probably going to rub off. There's probably over-the-counter fixers that are a lot more aggressive and will hold it there forever and ever in 1,000 days. You could probably even scratch it with your fingernail. and it won't come off. But I don't need that level of indestructibility in my models because, again, I don't play with them, so they don't need that. Once I build them, they either go on a diorama and go on the shelf, or they go on a little piece of wood and they go on the shelf, and they're just going to stay there. So I don't need to fix the pigments like they're concrete. Now, mind you, the terpenoid it's a pretty good fix. I mean, you know, I can touch this. It's not going to come off too easily. A little bit of it, but it's still drying. So, you know, just a little bit will come off at the moment, but it's still kind of wet. I mean, it just hit it with the hairdryer like 15 minutes ago, so it'll probably take a couple of days for it to completely harden up. Now, if you wanted to make it so that it'll never come off, you can make a fixer quite easily out of some water and thin PVA, PVA white glue, in other words, mixed with the water and a little bit of alcohol, rubbing alcohol. You make that into a suspension, and it'll work as a fixer as well, and be very strong. It'll probably never come off. But it's a little harder to work with because it doesn't soak in, doesn't have that capillary action that thinner based, like the terpenoid based thinner would have. Alright, so like I said, I'm adding this pigment all around the crew areas, areas where dust will get picked up and thrown onto the chassis. And mostly just the lower areas. I'm not going to go crazy on the upper areas. Now this color that I've picked on here is like countryside color. The color that you would see if this thing was driving around like in the countryside, off-roading or off in the country roads. The diorama, the road is a dirt road. It's a gray gravel dirt road. I might actually be changing that. I'm not 100% sure yet. It'll still probably be a grayish color, but it'll be maybe a more earthy tone of it. And so this may not be as much of a thing. But, if I decide not to do anything about it and just leave it the way it is, before I put this on the diorama, I would take a little tiny bit of, I have some pigment made up that is like road gravel color. It's like a dark-ish, dustish, like a concrete gray color. And I would do what I'm doing now over what I've already done in certain spots. Not a lot, just enough to give it a blending effect so that it would look like this thing has traveled on the surface that it's sitting on. So there's a blending, transfer of color from one surface to another. So that the vehicle is part of the diorama. It sits in the diorama rather than on the diorama. It's something you want to avoid. You don't want your vehicle to look like it's sitting on the diorama. You want it to be part of the diorama or sit in the diorama. Taking some of this pigment and pushing it into some of the nooks and crannies so it looks like it's accumulated dust and dirt. Not enough that there's a pile, just enough that there's a, you can see the color. This is kind of, I guess, a little bit like another version of a dot filter, in a way. Or I'm adding another tone of color. You can do the same sort of thing with pastel pencils. It's another layer on top of what I'm doing already. You can do this if you wanted more delicate, subtle weathering. It's more subtle than what I'm doing now. What I'm doing now is fairly subtle. It's not overly so. But if you want to go even more subtle, you can do this with watercolor pencils. Don't use the water, just use the dry pencils. You can use the watercolor pencils also to do something of a wash. But that's another thing. I don't really use them for that purpose. When I use the watercolor pencils, I use them a lot for what I'm pretty much what I'm doing now, but for more subtle type effects. They're like a fine detail tool. So that's what I use them for anyway. That's what I reserve them for. I don't need them for anything else. Right. So, that's done. That didn't take too long. Now, this is a bit of a tricky bit. This is my oil paint from before. Don't need this. Specific brushes for doing washes for clays and stuff like that and everything. And I just wanted to make sure that brush went where it's supposed to go. Alright. Now I'm going to, for this I'm going to use an older brush. Recently I just got a bunch of new brushes and I was trying them out. These ones. These brushes here. I just got them out, got them a little while ago. I was trying them out. Not totally sold on them yet. I'm used to using these. I've been using these old Tamiya bamboo brushes for years and years and years. I have a set of Winsor Newton, not Winsor Newton, the Series 7 brushes, but I don't really use them. They're too expensive, and you fuck them up. They stay fucked up. So, yeah, it was a mistake buying them. I should have just stuck to what I'm used to. I don't need those fancy brushes. I can do the same thing with these. So, but these ones, those Army Painter ones, are a reasonable price. So I thought I'd give them a try and see what happens. Now, basically, I'm doing the same thing that I did before. So I'm grabbing some of the oil and a bit of thinner, like you just saw me there. And I'm going to go back in. Need more thinner. It's got to be a little bit wet because you want it to stain the surrounding pigment. Because that's the effect you're going for, so that it's affected the surrounding pigments. So this is, I don't know if you've ever seen or used like a bicycle and taken it out in like on the trail and stuff like that, and over time the chain becomes all choked with dust and dirt and stuff and everything. That's kind of the effect I'm going for now. I'm choking the dust and the dirt on the wheels with some grease. At least that's the plan anyway. That's all that's supposed to represent. It's just grease stains left over from the guys adding grease and stuff to the hubs, and you know, it contaminates the surrounding mud and dirt. You're supposed to wait until the stuff is 100% dry before you do this. But I didn't, because I have no patience. That's why you see it moving, because it's not dry. And I have no patience at all. The ones that I'm putting up here, I'm gonna add a little bit of gloss paint to once this is done and they're dry, so that they have a bit of shine and they look like they're damp, not wet, just damp. And that's all. Right. Okay. So that bit's done. And that's the last thing I was going to show you in this video. So the next video will be the last video on this, and it will be the details. It's not that many on this one. It's mostly dealing with the stowage. The stowage here has to be dealt with. I have to dry brush it and paint a little, like some metal buckles. I have to clean up some of the rope, and I need to maybe put a little bit of rust on the tow cable here, and some metal effects on the barrel of the gun, and on the tow cable, and on the shiny points that are on the tip of the hedgerow cutter. And I have to do a little bit of metal work on the shovel and the pickaxe. The teeth on the tracks need to have a little bit of shine on there, and then I'll do the pigment that I do for the final attachment to the diorama. Now the diorama is not done. That was a long way from done, I think. So you won't see that for a little bit. That'll be another spotlight video, I think. Yeah, so I'm going to take some pictures of this, and you're going to see them in a second. Actually, you're looking at them now because I've taken the pictures. Actually, I haven't taken the pictures, but I'll edit them in because you're seeing them now. So that's what this thing looks like now in detail, I guess. And I'm hoping that maybe tomorrow I'll film the last video for this. And then I'll probably just upload this. That's what I'll do. And then I'll work on the other spotlights. So anyway, that's all I got for this. You guys be good. Keep your stick on the ice. Bye for now.
Great.